Hey, how's it going? This is Chad Haig reporting from Southern India. I'd like to do a series of videos on Aristotle's The Metaphysics. This will be the first in a series of three or four videos, this one covering books 1 through 4. Now, this is a response to a poll where you, the patrons, voted on which text you would like to open the school with a serious study of, and Aristotle's Metaphysics won in a tie with Hegel's Phenomena of the Spirit. And several of you also mentioned individually that a study of Plato and Aristotle is necessary to open any study of Western philosophy, because you won't really fully understand what came after Aristotle, I would argue, if you don't know what his theories actually were. Even if you have this negative dismissal of the concept of substance, essence, etc., you won't really understand that if you haven't read Aristotle's works. And that is precisely because his idiosyncratic terms have simply become a part of everyday conversation. Even somebody who's never read a single word by Aristotle will find it hard to go through a single day without saying words like nature, or essence, or substance, or accident, etc. And the danger is that the term has become so familiar that you don't really know what Aristotle meant by it himself, unless you do this hard work of actually reading his ideas themselves. And that's what we will be doing in these videos. So he opens the text in book one by arguing that it is human nature to desire to know. And this is evidenced not only in, you know, dabbling in these obscure systems of knowledge like astrology or geometry or metaphysics itself. Even something as mundane as the pleasure you get from your senses show this. The five senses are literally tools for learning. They channel a steady stream of sensory information to us, and we get pleasure out of it. Yet even among these five, they're not all equal. Aristotle says sight has a privileged position. And that is because it is the most suited for letting us literally see the differences among things. It's no coincidence, then, that the word theory is etymologically related to the Greek term for seeing. It's not related to the Greek term for smelling or tasting. You look at the Greek term theoria, which we translate into theory. That's contemplation or speculation, the kind that you would get from a theoros or a spectator. Okay, that's what a theoretician actually is. There's a subtle metaphysical presupposition here, which is worth dwelling on for just a little bit, especially in relation to our reading of Nietzsche. I would recommend you check the video on Twilight of Idols recently posted. Aristotle views difference as useful, but still secondary to the identity of the things, which he argues sight allows you to capture visual images of. And this is a idea which you see even reflected in somebody as recent as Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin also uses sight to find differences among the beaks of many different birds from different ecosystems. But this is merely a means to an end, to establish the identity of each type of bird. And Aristotle really arguably is the theoretical resource which Charles Darwin is using, even as he's studying natural selection's influence on anatomy on a scientific level. There's a metaphysical presupposition that sight is the most useful to establish the identity of different things, because it, among the five senses, is the most suited to the metaphysics of substance itself. This is why Nietzsche, who rejects this metaphysics in favor of an idea of being as will to power, favored smell over sight. Nietzsche argues that the snout, which picks up odors, discloses difference in itself rather than the difference of coherent images of things. But of course, that's a whole nother philosophical debate. If we return to Aristotle's own text, he argues that man can be distinguished from the lower animals in that, whereas the lower animals also have these five senses, or however many of them they might have, the lower animals basically just experience a stream of appearances. And even if they have memories, those are basically just a certain type of appearance. So human experience is just this stream of sensations. The human race, however, does not actually experience the world as that. Instead, he says humans live by art and reasoning. Humans have logos. Man is the animal with language and reason. Now, the translation art is misleading because he doesn't mean that, you know, man creates pottery and paintings and plays music. That's certainly true. Animals, at least as Aristotle understood them, don't do those things. But when he talks about art, the Greek word techne really means something like a certain knowledge, which implies comfort in the midst of a certain subject, as Heidegger translates that term for us in recent times. One becomes an expert in an art, for example, blacksmithing, by being very comfortable with the subject matter. That's true on a physical level, certainly, but also on an intellectual level. The kind of art which Aristotle has in mind here is the uniquely human knowledge, which comes from an understanding, from understanding these sensations themselves precisely through rising above them as such to grasp some universal notion to explain them. He says himself, "Now art arises when from many notions gained by experience, one universal judgment about a class of objects is produced. You have appearances maybe of Socrates and Callias' illness, okay? That's a matter of experience. But a judgment about all persons of a certain constitution is a matter of art. A judgment about the illness itself on a universal level is something you can only get if you have this sort of ability for techne, which he claims the animals lack." Or more specifically, we can say, as Aristotle does himself, that experience is knowledge of individuals, while art is knowledge of universals. Yet what kind of knowledge really is universal in this sense? Aristotle contrasts those who do not know why, those who merely experience these sensations, with those who do know the why, by arguing that the latter know the causes. The translation here is also misleading because the kind of cause Aristotle was talking about was not exactly the same as the ordinary English term. When most people use that term, they almost always mean the efficient cause. And that is certainly a legitimate example, but that is only one of four causes which Aristotle identified. Now, we'll just use the example of the statue of Catherine of Siena you see on the screen to explain these four. Now, there's the material cause. So first, there's the material cause, which for Aristotle really comes down to one of four elements. In his understanding of physics, everything you encounter is made of either earth, wind, fire, or water. And this statue has the matter or substratum, which for Aristotle is basically earth. Okay. And you can understand or explain it in one level by saying what it is made of, and that is the material cause. There is also, however, the formal cause, which he calls the essence or the why is reducible to definition. It's important to mention, by the way, that if you actually read Aristotle, these terms from the Aristotelian tradition, like efficient cause, formal cause, they don't so much show up. In fact, efficient cause is itself a medieval term from scholars, which you don't actually find in the text itself. You see these other terms, like he calls this the essence, and that is basically the definition. And if you look at this statue, the definition of it is this is a saint, right? An ascetic Catholic saint. And we know that because of the form. We know that this is a statue of a saint because it has this particular form rather than, say, the form of an elephant or a cow or something like that. Okay. This is why Aristotle is not a linguistic turned thinker. He doesn't think that the definition is a string of words. It is rather something which you can grasp simply through the form. Okay. And that is indeed another perfectly legitimate way of explaining or understanding what this thing is. There's also, however, the efficient cause. Once again, Aristotle doesn't use that term himself. He says the source of change in this context. And that is the mover who moved this into the form that it is. Basically, the sculptor was the agent who submitted this to the particular change, which causes it pun intended, to look the way that you see it right now. Okay, that's the efficient cause. When most people use the term cause, that's what they really mean. There's, of course, also the final cause, which is, as he calls himself himself in this context, the purpose and the good. This is the end for which all the generation and change is basically directed, okay? And the purpose of this statue is religious. The reason for this statue to exist and be used is worship. Okay. And therefore, you will understand what this is if you have its final cause along with the other three. Something is, however, very important on an epistemological level, which is, if you notice, you don't actually see all of these immediately. You don't see the final cause on the level of raw sensation, like an animal would. You kind of have to indirectly and intellectually restore that. You don't see the source of change immediately. You kind of have to intellectually restore that. But it's not only those two. You don't even really immediately see the material cause, because matter and form are always together. You only grasp it if you have the ability to abstract the material from the form. And similarly, you can only grasp the essence if you have this power of abstraction at a formal level as well. Okay, and therefore, he says, whereas even animals have experiences, that is, they have a stream of appearances and memories, wisdom is knowledge about certain principles and causes. Whereas everyone knows the kind of stuff accessible through perception by the senses, the universals are much more difficult to grasp. Yet even the universals themselves are not all equal. They rank in their own order of difficulty. He says himself, the most universal is the hardest for men to know, because these are farthest from the senses. Real knowledge does not reduplicate sense appearance. It is far from it, in the sense that it is knowledge of causes rather than the immediate sensations themselves. In fact, whereas modern thinkers confuse cause with efficient cause, Aristotle claims that his own predecessors tended to confuse material cause with the concept of cause in general. In other words, the study of metaphysics in large part prior to Aristotle was simply the misguided search for the ultimate material element of explanation. Thales thought metaphysics was the search for water. Diogenes favored air. Heraclitus said fire is the metaphysical principle. And Aristotle implied that these guys all missed the point by searching for the cause which was closest, not farthest, from the stream of appearances themselves. The higher thinker would realize that formal cause and final cause tell you more about the substance in question even than material cause. Therefore, in Book 2, Aristotle begins by basically agreeing with Plato that philosophy should strive for the truth. But whereas for Plato, this meant leaving behind this world for the world of ideas, for Aristotle, you don't have to actually do that. You need to instead know the causes. Aristotle's claim that the highest knowledge is farthest from the senses is therefore not a Platonic retreat into another world. It's rather a very different type of grasp of the same contents available in this world. It really is an early phenomenology. The thinker closest to Husserl is actually Aristotle. Most people don't know that. But this is the reason why. Ironically, this knowledge is not won through subtracting the being of this world, but rather through getting closer and closer to that being. Aristotle says, rather than work with a binary of truth and false truth values, basically, he understands there to be something like a hierarchy of different degrees of truth. He says that which causes derivative truth to be true is most true. Hence, the principles of eternal things must be always most true. Ultimately, this is because more truth equals more being. There's a type of formula for Aristotle in which, as each thing is in respect of being, so it is in respect of truth, he says himself. Therefore, in Book 3, he says that although he establishes a hierarchy, he warns the reader that there must be first principles if one is to avoid the problem of infinite regress. He says, but evidently there is a first principle, and the causes of things are neither an infinite series nor infinitely various in kind. This makes sense intuitively. The chain of efficient causes has to terminate somewhere, and this is why Thomas Aquinas and Al-Farabi later used this Aristotelian principle of a first mover as the evidence of God's existence. But it's not only efficient causes, it's also final causes that have to terminate somewhere. If there wasn't some ultimate good for which every action was being done, It wouldn't even be possible to act. Action would not be possible unless that chain of motivations terminated somewhere. The ancient Greeks realized that without foundations, you will either have infinite regress or circular reasoning. And in Euclidean geometry, this leads to the need for axioms or truths which can't be proven. But for Aristotle, this leads to not only these epistemological constructs, but even metaphysical foundations. And that is where you get substance. However, Aristotle finds that the hierarchy is more than just a chain of causes which all lie on the same level. In other words, there's not just the chain of efficient causes terminating in God. There's not just the chain of final causes terminating in the good itself. Even among the four causes themselves, all of them are not equal. In the ladder of knowledge, grasping essence ranks higher than grasping the mover or the material. Yet Aristotle is even more specific than that. He says, but inasmuch as it was described as dealing with the first causes and that which is in the highest sense the object of knowledge, the science of substance must be the nature of wisdom. That's because he knows most fully who knows what a thing is, not he who knows its quantity or quality or what it can by nature do or have done to it. In other words, reaching the categorical layer of substance is higher than dwelling in the categories of quantity-quality relation, as I will show you with the full list in just a few slides. So Aristotle therefore poses a very strange but fascinating question, whether the science of substance and the science which deals with axioms are different, or which of them is by nature more authoritative and prior than the other. In other words, is the science of substance, that is metaphysics, the same thing as the science of Euclidean axioms, which is, I guess, merely epistemological? Aristotle finds that this ultimately hinges on what exists. If you only accept the existence of sensible substances, then this is different from if you also accept the existence of Platonic forms, which Aristotle argues would have to be both cause and self-dependent substance if they existed. Yet Aristotle argues that the distinction is more apparent than real. Plato's idea that there is such a thing as man himself, or horse itself, and health itself in this other world, basically just argues that they are the same thing as sensible substances. The only difference is the categorical qualification of time. They are eternal, or last forever, and therefore are substances just as eternal men or eternal sensible things. Otherwise, on a categorical level alone, you're still actually just dealing with a substance, and therefore this is not a refutation of Aristotle's own way of understanding this hierarchy. If, on the other hand, there's nothing apart from individual things, and the individuals are infinite in number, how then would it be possible to get knowledge of infinite individuals? The only answer could lie in the need for essence. Aristotle's point seems to be that essence must be something different from an eternal body, which is otherwise indistinguishable from an earthly one. The kind of knowledge must be grasping the meaning of the thing qua essence through understanding its form on a level even more primordial than that of language. His distinction between knowledge of appearances and knowledge of things far from appearances at the beginning seems to suggest that seeing an object and seeing its essence are not necessarily the same thing. You can easily do the former while missing the latter. You can see circular things in, you know, daily life without grasping the essence of the circle. But that does not mean leaving this realm for the Platonic world of ideas. You simply have a different kind of standpoint towards the thing itself. What, therefore, is substance? Since ultimately this comes down to a distinction between substance itself versus the modifications of it. This is what Aristotle calls motions, but keep in mind that this translation is also misleading because motion in Aristotelian philosophy means all changes, not just a change in location. He says, for modifications in movements and relations and dispositions and ratios do not seem to indicate the substance of anything. They are all predicated of a subject, and none is in itself a this. The body which is modified alone persists as something real and as substance. In other words, for Aristotle, the question, what are objects, is something which he admits objects might include sensible and mathematical objects as both equally valid. But the question whether forms in the Platonic sense might make up a third class remains problematic. And this is complicated because substance is a this, and therefore not universal, yet the form is precisely something which is both this and a universal at the same time. Forms are therefore impossible results, which contradict their own definition. He says, if they're universal, they're not substances, for everything that is common indicates not a this, but a such. But a substance is a this. If we confuse this distinction, we will be led to argue that Socrates is several animals, because he is himself, but he's also man, and he's also animal. And if each of these indicates a this and a single thing, then you'll have many Socrates. And of course, this leads to the question whether you're dealing with the universal concept of a man or an animal as something different from the individual Socrates himself. This difficulty is unavoidable if one hopes to simultaneously satisfy Plato's demand for universal knowledge and the intellectual act of grasping an individual substance at once. Therefore, in Book 4, Aristotle introduces the concept of a science which investigates being as being, by warning that such a science of being would not be the same as any of the so-called special sciences. The mathematical sciences are not this science, for example, because they don't study being. They study a part of being which have been cut off and submitted to a particular kind of analysis. This tendency to confuse the study of being with the study of particular types of beings largely just stems from language. On the surface, the same word being is used for many different cases. He says himself, there are many senses in which a thing might be said to be, even including non-being. We say of non-being that it is non-being. Okay, what can being be if even non-being can be said to have it? And Aristotle argues that there's something of a hierarchy of senses of being itself, which you don't see if all you look at is the surface structure of language. You have to go beyond that to the realm of metaphysics itself. And you'll see, if you do that, that all of these other senses of being refer to one starting point, which is substance itself. Other senses of being include things like affections of substance, processes towards substance, destruction or privation or qualities of substance, or things which are relative to substance, negations of one of these things of substance or substance itself. If this science, however, will deal with that which is primary and on which the other things depend, then in the case of metaphysics, this will be itself substance. It will be substance that the philosopher uses to grasp the principles and causes. Contrary to expectation, this does not mean physics. He warns physics is also a kind of wisdom, but it is not the first kind. You have to keep in mind that for Aristotle, physis means something more like what we translate it as nature, but it's something like the emerging without technical intervention from man of the thing into a certain form, which you see with like the organic growth of plants, etc. That's sort of the kind of physics he means, rather than the modern notion of physics. Okay, so this hierarchy is not visible through language alone, since the same word will be used to refer to different layers. The subject will have to learn to recognize these distinctions with a different type of toolkit. This is the hierarchy of categories itself. For example, with language alone, it is hard to explain why Socrates and Socrates seated are both references to the same guy, but with different categorical layers emphasized. The difference really is just that Socrates himself gives you a glimpse into the category of substance, while Socrates seated is the same substance, but with a modification indigenous to one of these other higher order categories. Substance, of which the sophists have no correct idea, is prior to all of these other things. It's strange how substance travels into all of the higher categories. It's there, of course, in its own category, but it's also there in all of the other ones. You look at the hierarchy of categories explained through the example of an elephant. I put the Greek terms on as well, if in case you speak Greek, to see how the notion of quantity, the second category, for example, you're kind of asking, like, how much, how many? Okay, and you can give an answer for that. There is an elephant, and we know how much or how many. Okay, we also know quality. What kind? Well, it's a gray elephant, right? That's a quality. There's a relation. This elephant is caught up in relations with other things, right? And you can talk about those in this category. There's also a place. Where is this elephant? There's a time. When? There's a position. Which he actually, the actual Greek word is more like, there's a certain lying about this elephant, right? There's a certain ability for this elephant to have. That's literally what that word in Greek is, and this is its ability to have a state or condition. There's also a doing to this elephant, or a making. There's also its ability to passively be affected, and to undergo or suffer on a literally pathological level, as a synonym, or rather etymologically related to that word. Okay, therefore, there's something of a dichotomy between substance itself and its attributes, which is captured in the higher order category. Some attributes are essential, others are accidental. Accident, however, is also not exactly the best translation, since most people think of an accident as an unfortunate event which happened involuntarily. You had an accident at work that left your leg injured, etc. But you should really think of accident more in the music theory sense. In music theory, an accidental is a note played within a piece which does not actually belong in that particular scale. You introduce sharps or flats in the musical notation to explicitly direct the musician how far outside the normal scale he or she should travel to reach this accidental. Accidental is therefore something present, which does not belong to the essence of the thing. Excuse me. It's like the note A flat appearing in the F major scale. Similarly, Aristotle's favorite example of an accidental attribute of humans is color. A man will be a man, regardless of which color he is. Another is profession. A man might be a healer, but not all men are. That is an accidental attribute. One justification for contrasting substance with higher order attributes is that whereas accidents are potentially infinite, substance is just one. This distinction is far from trivial, by the way. Aristotle warns us that if all attributes were accidental, predication would be effectively impossible, since it would go on forever in infinite regression. It could never actually happen. Further, if substance did not function as a hard epistemological limit on predication, there would be no reason why contradictories couldn't be predicated of the same thing at the same time. In addition, there's a logical problem of recursion. Accidents must be of a substance, since if accidents were attributes of other accidents, you would also have a type of infinite regress. Therefore, Aristotle concludes that this sort of indeterminacy we are trying to avoid is simply a feature not of being, but rather of non-being. Interestingly, he calls this sort of indeterminate non-being potentiality, and he contrasts it with the determinate being of actuality. Once again, the translation is a little misleading because we use these terms so often, we risk not grasping what exactly Aristotle meant by talking about something being actual. Aristotle understood substances do have certain potentialities which can be actualized. For example, every man has the potential to see because vision is a part of his essence. In some cases in the real world, however, he cannot actualize this potentiality. For example, he might have been born blind. Maybe he lost his eyesight later on in life, like Daredevil, the Marvel comic hero. Similarly, Aristotle says all birds have the potential to fly because flying is part of the essence of being a bird. The only reason why ostriches don't actualize this ability is because their wings just happen to be a little too small. Aristotle would argue if you gave bigger wings to an ostrich, he would fly because it's part of his nature. Likewise, actuality ranks higher than mere potentiality for the same reason that being ranks higher than non-being. In an Evolian sense, this is part of the traditional view that actuality is form, whereas potentiality is mere matter, as Aristotle says in other places. Likewise, on a logical level as well, assertion and denial require the existence of some substance, since these require a subject about which these statements would be made. Another difference is that whereas contradictories can coexist in potentiality, they cannot in actuality, in which only one of two contradictory states can be realized. If you don't have substance, you would have a strange metaphysical monism encompassing all contradictions for that reason. This is the truth about any claim to overcome the metaphysics of substance, by the way, in that Aristotle claims that Heraclitus, who Nietzsche praises, basically gives you a world in motion, devoid of substance. Yet this was the result of falling for the sense error itself, or thinking that that which is identical with the sensible world alone. Likewise, appearance really is not enough for Aristotle. Heraclitus missed the point that motion or change is what happens to a substance. It makes no sense except as higher order operation that already presupposed that foundation. In contrast with unbridled empiricism, therefore, Aristotle asserts there is something beyond the sensation itself, which must be prior to it, for that which moves is prior in nature to that which is moved. Okay. Interestingly, he also warns that if substance is not presupposed, the appearances themselves will not be freed up to grant better empirical knowledge to us, as some might argue. Rather, they will just devolve into a chaotic mixture of fleeting appearances and nothing more. They will say that what appears is true, and therefore that all things are alike, false and true, for things do not either appear either the same to all men or always the same to the same man. Russell realized the same thing, in that the same thing can appear different to the same man, even intentionally changing the color by putting on a pair of colored glasses. However, the truth about things must be found by some means other than the stream of sensations themselves, a point which Aristotle and Russell both realized, although for very different reasons. So this is the end of the first video. Thank you so much. I look forward to continuing this series.